So we started recording. I thought we were already started. My first few minutes of English will be a bit rough, but I hope I'll improve in a few minutes after that. We're going to have a talk about public key infrastructure and transport layer security, also known as SSL. The SSL is the old name. We stick to the new name, TLS. If you see this somewhere in my slides, try to correct me. There should be at least once where I mentioned the term SSL. You can flag it as a remark, as more paying good attention. So my name is Oscar Kurau. I work at the CISO office in the team strategy and policy. You can also find me on Twitter, but don't nag me too much. I already have too much followers. So I worked at a subatomic physics laboratory for about 10 years. I made it, well, partially possible. Hey there. I made it possible that supercomputers could connect over the internet with each other, share data, share computing power, and we're talking about big systems, so and the internet, so bold internet. Interesting infrastructure. How do you do this? Very securely. And this is has been quite some time for quite some time, pretty heavy work. I've been working with OpenSSL and really hacking on that level of the software stack for quite some years, which gained me quite some knowledge about SSL, TLS, how that works, certificates, PKI. How do you really handle this stuff? Because a lot of people are knowledgeable about providing you with certificates or installing the certificates, but how do you debug the fault situations, buggy situations, or anything else? These are very complicated stuff. I've been, I had the opportunity to work for KPN after that. The CISO for KPN, Chief Information Security Officer for KPN, Jay Abelou, came to me once and gave me the opportunity to work in the KPN Red Team. The Red Team is the ethical hacking team of KPN. Basically what we do is we hack our stuff first before we set it to market so that you can hack it, and then make a huge PR fuss about it that you guys hacked it. Because, well, consider the situation that we put in a new system, a new application, a new app, and one of you guys hack it and go to a journalist and we look bad. So this is what we try to prevent, at least in the KPN Red Team. We hack it first. Send a report, blame the supplier, well, hit them with a clubbed, and then we move on. After about 10 months, I had the opportunity to work, because I was already busy, like, okay, how do we structurally fix all these things, but now prevent everything of happening? And I got the opportunity to work in the strategy and policy team, and I'm, well, one of the most technical guys over there. And I'm burdened with all the topics about crypto, identity, mobile device management, and network policies throughout the entire KPN company. So pretty challenging, though, because, well, not everybody has a deep down knowledge about all these things, and I hope in time you guys will. So, goals of this talk. We're going to talk about TLS, about PKI, what is a certificate, what is this padlock in your browser, how do you analyze the TLS handshake, what goes in, what goes out, what's being passed along to actually make this happen. Some good practices, some bad practices are also shown. And I go into some case studies from the past. And well, the man in the middle walkthrough, that will be part of your assignments. So pop quiz, let's start out. For those who are already really enthusiastic, I wanted to see some hands about, do you know at least five of these terms on the slide? That's pretty good. Which one? What? Good one. There's at least one sharp guy in the audience. Who can? Who knows at least 10 of these? Some. Okay. Eventually, after this entire exercise, you'll probably not be acquainted with what S-MIME would be. And PGP, we only glance over this one. But all the others will be, well, common knowledge after this. Oh, and the DES and triple DES, that one I also don't go into. It's old technology. TLS and certificates, the entire PKI stuff, it's everywhere. Everywhere in daily life. But if we peel off daily life and we talk about the protocol stack that we see this stuff appearing in HTTPS, the most common situation, but also WebDAV, CalDAV, CardDAV, XMPP, Jabber, Chat, but also IMAP, POP, SMTP. And luckily enough, these days, not just SMTP from me to my mail server, but also between the mail servers. It's a whole story on why the internet is still not secure and why your email is not secure. It's because typically your email is sending clear text after you just send it securely to your mail provider. Nice. This is how the internet works. It sucks. And there's no good way of going about this, unfortunately, unless we move up with DMARC, DKIM, and all kinds of other protocols and stuff that also goes into cryptography, but not for today. I guess everybody uses EduRoam. Yes, nodding, okay. EduRoam, do you know the protocol on this list that goes into this one? Bingo. So the 802.1x is a very open standard, and one of the things that happens is that you make an authenticated connection to the backend service, and then if this is all okay, then you send your password over this connection, you authenticate, and you after the authentication is done, you get Wi-Fi access. Who uses Android phones? Yes. Luckily, I don't have my gear with me to just nag all your passwords. But Android has a flaw, and I go into how this one works. Windows Phone users, which model?
Lumia 1020.
Ah, it's too new. Too bad. So a few models before we had there was also an interesting way of intercepting all your SSL, which was really bad.
Make sure to repeat what I said in the password question.
Oh, this is just intro. Whoops. So we're going to talk about this padlock here. Mostly about what goes into the lock and behind that lock and what really states here. Now, we can see already a few things. Somehow this connection is HTTPS. We see it's green. We see it's you're connected to kpn.com and it gets my address information. It knows who verified this connection, and it states it's secured. Now, how did my browser come to that conclusion? Let's step down a bit. Protocol stack first. Where is this TLS? The TLS is, well, you've got the IP TCP stuff, so this is the traditional model of how your protocols are stacked. On top of that, you have your HTTP, your FTP, your SMTP, and if you have a TLS layer in between, you can talk about the fact that you now have HTTPS or IMAPS or whatever. You've now secured the protocol that is carried within this secured container. TLS has a few types of messages, and we'll go into deeper detail on what this means and what this really carries. There's a handshake protocol. This is only used to set up this connection. There's a cipher change protocol which states, okay, we're now this is a communication method within TLS to state, okay, we're going to use this encryption technology now. And there's an alert protocol which is used like, okay, we're going to shut down this SSL connection. I said SSL, I mean TLS connection. Sometimes I grab myself. So, or any other things like please repeat a packet and do something with this. Eventually, we talk about this as a record protocol. So, the thing is, all the messages that go past actually through this connection, so you have a connection, it's always a fixed length. And why is this fixed length? It's to ensure that this part is always encrypted in the same way. And there's a homogene distribution van bits. Yeah. So basically, all the blocks are similarly fit. They're padded, and this is to prevent things like a decryption attack. How does that work? If you send a few bytes and you always know it starts with HTTP dash or space or slash, you always know this starts the same way. If you repeat this record a few times, you can see and you can do a statistical analysis on what goes into this packet. If they're smaller, I only encrypt just 5 bytes or 6 bytes. But if I know I have huge payloads, now let's just go in the fact that if I only have 5 bytes to transfer and I have 5 bytes to encrypt, I can figure out, oh, maybe it's sending the same 5 bytes over and over again. You can do a statistical analysis on how big these payloads are. This is how some of these crypto attacks work. Everything is encrypted, but I can deduce by a statistical attack that I now can figure out what kind of payload goes into these packets. It's a very hard one to do. Typically, you need to have quite some knowledge about the protocol and a very bad implementation of this record. So this is why all these records are always in fixed length transferred, so that you cannot do this statistical analysis based on this payload. So this is why the record protocol is as it is. TLS is only secure if you can figure out, or if you can state, that the integrity of the messages are okay, that the data is sent confidentially, and that you know who you just spoke to. Now, why is this? Let's consider all the options where, for instance, in the purple area, that authenticity is not we couldn't figure out who actually is on the other side of the line. We couldn't do this authenticity check. It failed or it's not implemented. There are cipher suites. There are combinations of encryption technology that actually does not use the authenticity stuff. So what this means is I try to talk to, for instance, a bank site or any other important site where I have my username and password to log on to. But I know that the data that I just sent over this encrypted connection is not manipulated, so it didn't change by content. I know it's encrypted. Nobody on this line could actually figure out what the content of this data is. But I had no idea that if I was talking to my bank to log on or just an intermediate hacker in between. This is what it means if you do not have the authenticity part checked. Likewise with other areas, if you can manipulate the data in flight, it doesn't really mean you have a secure connection, because you could now actually manipulate the data. Or, which also happens in VPN connections in some cases, we have integrity checks and we know who we talked to because this was authenticated. Everybody could read the data. This is what it means to me is that you can only state that TLS is as secure as you can cover all the other areas here. So if you cannot cover integrity control, confidentiality, or authenticity, basically you're not secure or you lack any of these features. So how do we achieve confidentiality by encryption? We have these technologies. We have symmetric encryption and we have asymmetric encryption. Symmetric encryption, AES, or is a technology to be used to encrypt data with just a key. So you have one key, and on both sides of the connection you share this key, and you can now encrypt data. The same would work with any of the others in the symmetric key. With asymmetric key, you have multiple keys. You have a private key and you've got a public key. And with the public key, you can do certain activities. And with the private key, you can the other way. So for instance, with a public key, if I have a public key, I can now do a transformation and, oh, wait a minute, I'll go into this. I'll go into this in a few slides, sorry. There are a lot of technologies out there with respect to ciphers, as we call them, encryption technologies. There are rotary machines. Think of the Caesar, the Enigma, for instance, but also other techniques. They had a rotary system. If you ever look on Wikipedia how an Enigma works on the inside, it has wheels in it, and when you turn it and you move the wheels a few steps, for instance, you have an alphabet on the ring, you move them a few steps, you can now figure out that all the alphabet letters are now moved. Rot 13. I don't know if you figured out how Rot 13 works. That's basically a similar system. And in modern technology, you see, for instance, the fact that you have one private key and then you have stream and block ciphers. I'll not go into the detail on the difference between stream and block ciphers. And you've got the public key and the private key methods. And AES, for instance, this is the basics of AES encryption. What happens is there are a certain amount of steps that happen 9, 11, or 13 times. This is how AES works. AES 128 has 9 or 11 steps. And basically what it does is you have to figure out there's a grid or a matrix of bytes or locations in memory. And what you do is you grab a byte, you put in your data, your plain text, and what you do is you substitute a byte by a key, or part of the key, you shift the row, you mix the columns again, and you add a round key again. And you do this shuffling, basically it's a shuffling technology, it's a shuffling technique, I mean, and based on the shuffling technique, you can encrypt your data. And on the other end, if you use the same key and you shuffle it exactly the same time with exactly 9, 11, or 13 rounds of the shuffling, you'll end up with exactly the same data again. This is how you convert your plain text to ciphertext and back again using a key. More discrete. Here you see the same method, and it's also very important to figure out that this technology of AES works best if you use an initialization factor. An initialization factor is the first 16 bytes, and it's random. Why is this random and you use the same plain text? It's very simple. If I would send a message to Arnhem, I use the same key and I have the same data to send, the ciphertext, the encrypted data, would exactly be the same if I would use the same password, for instance, to transfer. If he would use a password, I would use exactly the same password. We send this over the line, I can analyze it and see that my encrypted text is exactly the same as his. Now to bump this and make a change to this, the first round that you perform this shuffling technique is you use an initialization factor, a piece of random data. This is very important. So what you can see in a lot of applications is they messed up the fact that this initialization factor is set to zero or just blank. And the AES technique, sorry? Or worse, you think it's random, but it's not. For instance, you only use a component that's pretty predictable, like time. So if you just use a few bytes of that just come from your clock, and you use this as your initialization factor, if I know what time he actually sent this message, I could probably deduce by knowing the source code, for instance, or any other way of figuring out that he used this as the initialization vector, I could actually figure out his plain text by analyzing others or analyzing just this text. You had a question?
Yes, the initialization vector omitted if the payload is received or is it decrypted?
Basically, what you do is it depends on the technique around it, but you just ignore the first round, and then you use the same key on the other end, and you'll end up with exactly the same text. It's an interesting method. Yeah.
Could you repeat the question when you answer it, because then it will be recorded.
Ah. So the question was, what was the question?
Is the vector omitted, so removed, or is it actually read and decrypted on the other side?
Ah, yeah. So the question is if the initialization vector is omitted, or what you do it with this on the other side. Basically, the first round should be ignored of data, because you'll try to decrypt the garbage. And on the other hand, so you actually decrypt it exactly with the same way. It's just like the initialization vector becomes part of your plain text. But it's not. You know it's the first 16 bytes of random garbage, and you just ditch it. Just skip this. So the first piece of your plain text is always ignored, and this is how this works. Because now in flight, if you analyze this with Wireshark, you'll end up with exactly the same password being encrypted, but encrypted, so the ciphertext will be different in your Wireshark results. Same password, different ciphertext. So one of the important things today is you use secure pseudo-random number generators, PRNGs. And if you ever create apps, you write code, whatever, please consider the fact that there are these secure methods of creating your own random bytes. And don't just think of any other solution than just those who are here on the screen for this platform. Why is this? Every time when people try to figure out, I can figure out some random bytes and they look random, they're probably mathematically not random. At least this is one of those pitfalls. It looks random, but it's not. So on iOS you have secure random copy bytes. On Android you've got the secure random class, on which you actually also need to be careful on how you actually use this. Because if you use the set seed feature, then suddenly you put everything back to zero again, and zero is very predictable. On Unix system, you've got /dev random and /devurandom. On Windows, you've got a specific solution for this. .NET has its own, Perl, Java, PHP. If you ever code in PHP, use OpenSSL random pseudo bytes or the mcrypt create IV, for instance. Don't even think about anything else, because PHP is already horrible in itself. I know, because I actually use it. Huh? Yeah, build your own atomic clock, la la la. So there are also some interesting ones who are not secure. Question to the classroom: what about the first one? Does anybody recognize the first one? Okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so you guys are not into Edward Snowden, I guess. Too bad. So the NSA has most likely manipulated the standardization of elliptic curve dual. Random byte generator. Something or other. It's an elliptic curve technique, and you could have used any elliptic curve two numbers basically to make this random number generator work and spit out random numbers. But there is a relationship between those two initialization numbers, and those were standardized. Just use these said the standardization body. After quite some time, we figured out that people figured out that there was an implicit backdoor in this random number generator. And if you know the mathematical relationship between those two numbers that were just standardized, you might have a huge advantage in decrypting everything that was using this. So, and this was also published as part of the one of those Edward Snowden revelations, and unfortunately, basically this one got ditched as a secured random number generator, because the NSA might have quite a good advantage in decrypting everything randomized by this. The other one is from Intel. Does anybody know about this feature? Probably, I guess not. No, okay.
It's a hardware random feature in their processors, but I'm not sure if it's the latest.
Very good.
Recently upgraded something.
Yeah, so Intel indeed created an operand, RDR or RDRand, whatever. And this was one of the first ones ever built in. So a random function, not created by your operating system based on your mouse movements, stuff that was drawn in different GPU buffers and blah, blah, blah. No, your Intel CPU also pitched in and added this. Problem is, it's in hardware. And how do you check hardware? I can check source code. I cannot break open my CPU and figure out what all these wires were. So if you look at security and how to go about this in giving your statement, this is secure, this is not secure, cryptographers have stated that the solution built into the CPU of an Intel processor is actually not secure just by the plain fact that you cannot check this. You have no idea what goes in or what goes out and why. Yes?
Isn't it possible to log out what it generates?
Log out?
Yeah,
yeah.
I mean, show them
to
do
statistical analysis out of
RDRAM. Yeah, which is very hard because the EC Dual DRBG went through a few of these statistical analysis, and it took an Edward Snowden presentation leakage to figure out, oh God, we didn't look at it this way. So we don't know if they plant something into this or not, and you have no way of using it. So the Linux kernel doesn't take this as the only random input. But if you take this as the random input, you could say, yeah, mix it in with all the others. But now you have something that you could potentially influence by, I don't know what kind of means. So this is a tricky one. So in our KPN policy, we just stated, don't ever use this, just to be sure, just to be safe. But that's our tech profile that we have to take care of, these kinds of little details. Okay, let's go to Alice and Bob. Alice and Bob try to communicate to each other, and there's this Eve, and they both have keys, and Alice got the public key of Bob. And now, using the public key, she could transfer the plain text into ciphertext, send it over the line where Eve would be snooping all the data, and it could decrypt it again with the private key. And slightly more details. So RSA works like this. You choose two prime numbers, any prime numbers. Just pick two and they'll be good. Multiply them to be used as your modulus n. You choose a co-prime e for your public key, according to this schematics. You calculate d for your private key based on e times d mod lots. And you destroy all traces of p and q if you can. Okay, let's make it easier. So let's just assume we took 11 and 29 as your primes. The modulus would then end up being 319. Now we have to figure out a co-prime. Now what the hell is a co-prime? I know primes, but what is a co-prime? And it has to be equal to this. Okay, so we got this thing called Wolfram Alpha. It's your pocket calculator if you have the app, or it's this ginormous supercomputer that can create some coprimes. So the thing of coprimes is that it is a relative prime to this number. So we have to figure out a prime number relative to this one. Oh look, a huge list. Well, thank you. Okay, 3. We take the number 3. Now we have to figure out, okay, from this number we now need to create a private key. We do the same thing. Please solve 3 times x mod 280 is 1. Blah blah blah, x is 280 and plus blah. So one of the example answers would be 467. And obviously 467 is just a multiplication of 280 times n plus 187. So we just use 187. Yeah, follow math, okay. Just slow on math, I guess, okay. Anyway, this was the hardest math in this entire presentation, so just relax. Yeah? Okay. Okay, so we've got Alice and Bob and Dr. Evil. So you've got the modulus 319, we've got the public key is 3 and 187 for the other one. So how do we move this about? With this equations. So we take 65. Which letter is this in the ASCII table?
A.
We move this through m to the e to the third mod n modulus of 319. You end up with 285, and Dr. Evil is pretty sad still. And on the other hand, we have our ciphertext. We elevate this to D187 mod n, and we end up with 65. This was our RSA encryption. Pretty easy. So, yeah, this was the hardest math to as far.
RSA is insecure.
Sorry?
Does that mean RSA is insecure?
Why?
If you can factor the primes.
Ah, if you can factor the primes.
That's a calculation.
With these numbers, yes, easy cheesy. I work with prime numbers that fit in the 2 to the 248 bit key lengths, or 2 to the 4096 bit key length. Hit that one on the calculator and you'll see a huge number which doesn't fit really on one line. So then it becomes very hard, and it becomes a needle in the haystack to figure out what the primes were that you actually used here. And because of the calculation being very complicated, to figure out what my private key was based on the public key, because from the 3 and from the 319 and the 187 there's no backwards relationship to the private key, we can assume that RSA is still secure and good for your online banking. So, back to the principles of TLS. Integrity, confidentiality, and authenticity. You need all 3 to be secure. Let's go into the message digest stuff. So this is the integrity part. So you've got these cryptographic hash functions, one-way hash functions. According to Arnim, you already were acquainted at least a bit about the one-way hash functions. Which one of these 3 is not recognized? SHA-3. Very good. So SHA-3 is, what was it, somewhere end of last year, was standardized as the new method of hashing technology. Unfortunately, it's so new, there's no hardware or software that, well, there is software, but there's no hardware that works with this. It's not common yet. Everybody's still moving from the SHA-1 to the SHA-2 family, which is SHA-256 to SHA-512, and so on. Everybody has a hard time moving from this one to this one already with all kinds of software that really needs it. We're going to message authentication code. This is a key hash message authentication code. So now you have a key and the hash algorithm, and together you can now figure out if somebody who had the key actually manipulated the data and how to verify this. So just to rehash on hashing functions. This is, for instance, if I'm not mistaken, this is SHA-1 or MD5. I'm always a bit wary on what it exactly is. So you take in the input, you change a few letters on the output. For instance, you change the red fox jumps over the blue dog. The red fox jumps over the blue dog, or any other change. And the key takeaway here is that the result of the hash function, the digest, is significantly different based on any bit that you change. Not a byte, any bit that you change from the input, and that goes through this this hash function, will dramatically change the other side. And based on the other side, so it's a one-way hash function, from this data, you cannot move back easily back to the original plain text. So these are the key takeaways of hash functions, and specifically one-way hash functions, that you cannot move backwards. You can only move forwards with this. There's a HMAC-like Mac, or any Mac versions. This is not Mac My Apple. This is Mac, the technology message authentication code. So it takes a key and an algorithm of choice. There are quite a few. And you build a message digest, but now you are required to have a key. And on the other side, you need the same key again to put the message through the same algorithm again with the same key. And only on that side, you can figure out if the actual MAC digests are the same. Now, what does this achieve? This achieves you that you need to figure out that either side have a key and use the same key, use the same data to actually make this digest. So I now have a pretty good idea on actually who sent this, because now I have a tie to a key, and I could hook up anything something else to this and figure out that some identity sent this message and it was not changed all at once. So here again, You've got a sender, you create the signature, we share a key, and based on the fact that we share the same key and I got the message, I can now figure out that this message and the digests match together, so that the input message and signature were exactly the same. So I know that whoever has this key, and as long as we've not had this key leak on the internet or pastebin or anything else that leaks publicly, I can exactly know who actually sent this. But there's another technology that's called a digital signature algorithm. It's when we use the same private key and public keys that we just saw in Alice and Bob's example, do the same thing, but now we check against the public key that was sent over. So I have a certificate, I have the public key of the sender on the recipient side. And based on the fact that this sender has used its private key to create this signature, because of this relationship between the private and the public key, I can now figure out with the public key of the sender that this message was not manipulated in flight, was not changed, and I actually now know that it was signed by the only person on this planet, mathematically speaking, who actually possessed this private key. So this makes a very strong link. And this technology is used in SMIME, in email, or PGP, to figure out if the message was indeed from this person. Um, We've covered the confidentiality, the integrity, and now we move into the realm of certificates and how they actually work. We've got two types of certificates in mainstream. Certificates that are belonging to a public key infrastructure, PKI, and we've got PGP certificates, who are based on a web of trust. Who has a PGP certificate? There's a very strong PGP force here. Okay. Too bad. So this is a certificate. Not really readable, is it? This is a Base64 encoding of a certificate. And if we use our browsers, we can figure out that this could be read slightly more easily. It's this certificate with all these parameters that basically build up the content of a certificate. So what we will see in a certificate is the public key, could be RSA, DSA, or elliptic curve, EC for the elliptic curve. The signature from the authority that signed this one, the CA. How this works, I'll go into detail on that later. Usability info, like who's the owner, what's the purpose of this certificate, should it be used for web servers, should it be used for personal use, what type of certificate is it? Validity information, a lot of other stuff, and aside to this certificate, there's the private key installed on the host. Let's dive into this shell, for instance. Any popular website? Pick one.
Facebook.
Okay. Facebook. Anything that you could call Facebook. Bad encryption. Okay. Here you see a similar thing like I just saw on, that you just saw on the slides. So what did I just do? I made a connection using OpenSSL S client. So OpenSSL is a command line tool, but there's also a library. It also has a lot of, well, I call this my Swiss Army knife. It also has a client, it even has a service. So there's also S underscore server, and you can do a lot of funny things with that. Then you connect, and I connect to port 443, which is for? HTTPS, yes. I can see they have a certificate, a high assurance CA certificate. Blah, 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 some error messages that I could wave away because I didn't make another little setting. And I can see the certificate. Okay, well, that's nice, but it doesn't really show me what's in the certificate. So how do I show this to you guys? And failed. Facebook. So obviously OpenSSL also has an analysis tool to just look into the contents of certificates. And look and behold. So here's the top side of the certificate again, but now the Base64 actually encapsulated a DER, DARE formatted, which is a binary way of resembling all this. As you can see, it follows just like code. It's like, I don't know, if you've any it's indenting. You can see the indenting. So for the Python programmers, this should feel natural. It's basically an ASN1 is a technology. It's a binary equivalent to XML, as it were. It has nodes and lists, and within that lists you can, so you can see this as objects, lists, and how to work with those. So what you can see here is you can see what type of version of certificate it uses. Version 3, this is the most common one. You see there's a serial number, a unique number. In they try to make it as unique as possible on the planet of the Earth, but typically this is scoped to whoever gave this certificate to Facebook. And the person that actually gave this was this issuer. DigiCert is the company, not VeriSign or Symantec or any other of those known. DigiCert is an American company that gives out certificates, and those are identified by this string, the issuer distinguished name. The certificate is valid until April 13 of this year. What date is it today? Nah, soon they'll get some email from DigiCert to like, hey, I would probably change your certificate on the main page. Might help. Because otherwise users will get an error. Because your certificate is not valid anymore, and not valid certificates will boil down in an error on your browser. So the official name is the subject distinguished name, which is this line over here. And in this case, it's valid. They try to make it valid for anything facebook.com, so www.facebook.com, but also login.facebook.com, because this is a wildcard, or smtp.facebook.com, or anything which would match here. So if we move up, we see an RSA public key. They use a 2048 bit RSA key, and this is the modulus. Well, you could say this is the equivalent of the public key with an exponent and all kinds of other details that I don't want to dive into because it's a bit much. Here you can see in detail for which sites and subsites this is good for. And here, this is a funny one. Does anybody know what this means? Yes, okay, so that part you do know. Very good.
What?
So, very good. So this is indeed an experiment launched quite some time. So this Facebook actually created a Tor hidden service. And even the SSL between the Tor hidden service and the actual Facebook system can now also be verified based on the fact that this is in here. And how this works, we'll dive into details, not so much on how what an onion does, but what all these DNS statements are. Here you can see that this with the X509 key usage, that you can use the digital signature method, which I've just explained with the MUC and the digital signature technology. This certificate is good for this one. You can use it. You can use it for key encipherment, so if you want to transfer keys. So you can do Diffie-Hellman key exchange and other technologies. You can use the certificate, so the purpose of the certificate, you can use it as a web server and as a client. Why would I make this good for a client? Anybody guess? Any API programmers? No, okay. If you have a service, you can connect to the service, but this certificate could also authenticate to a back-end system again. And now it's a client. You can use the same certificate for client connection as well. This is how you deal with big infrastructures. They have a CRL certificate revocation list, distribution points, multiple of them. Those are from DigiCert, from the CA. Will be explained later. There's a certain policy. This is a unique name for expressing a policy, object identifier, which is registered. And this basically means to state, okay, according to this CPS documents, this certificate for this for DigiCert are obliged and are regulated by this policy, and this policy probably states something about what kind of flags you should enable and disable if DigiCert would ever bring out a certificate, and it was signed and distributed under this policy. Now, why is this so important? I mean, we're talking about crypto and technology and whatever. But if we don't make very clear statements on what this certificate is good for, then this also boils down into this trust model. You have to have some trust in what type of CA this is, because otherwise I could give out anything or create bogus certificates for all kinds of organizations or whatever. And this is basically stated in there that you that they won't do this kind of evil thing. OCSP endpoints and the signature from the embodiment, the CA that actually gave this one out. Yeah. Yeah, this will definitely be flagged as a too bad, too sad SHA-1 certificate, but then again it's bound to be expired, so they'll probably move up to something new, I hope. Good. Blah blah. So issuer, serial, basic constraints. And I didn't go into that part. The basic constraint for this is, for this certificate that we just saw is set to false because it's not a certificate authority. It was a host certificate, an endpoint certificate. And only certificates who can sign other certificates have this flag enabled. And might also have a path length constraint. This means that if you have a certificate, it could not be signed by another CA. I will go into detail on that detail as well. Yes, there's a lot of details here. Other purposes than the one we just saw is email protection. If a certificate has this flag on, it could be used by me. I don't have my company card here, but see my bag. If I have a personal certificate, I would have this flag on, and probably not as that one. This is because this is really to create services with my certificate, and email protection is to state this certificate is now good for my email address, oscarcuro@kpn.com, or my private, depends. But there are also other purposes, and any Java programmers here? Oh, Java programmers. Code signing. Any burden or any problem experience with the fact that you didn't sign your code before? Okay, this might happen in some environments. If you don't sign the code by a code signing embodiment or anything that the system can trust, in some cases you cannot even run your executable because this safeguards the change of your binary. So the digital signature on email, like is my email manipulated, yes, no, this also works on binaries. And there are systems like the operating system Windows that could check this. And this works even on script files. So any PowerShell users? One daring people? Okay, well, you typically have to set the policy locally on disabled, especially on server nodes, to run your own PowerShell scripts. And this is because your code or your script was not signed. And you need certificates like these somewhere that are trusted and have this ability for code signing, because otherwise you cannot distribute your own source code, at least not in secure environments. There's also something to do with atomic clocks and sending very secured and time-stamped data and signing OCSP. This is really other stuff. Da-da-da. Went already for this. Yeah, so we've just saw a lot of these DNS queries, of which a few of them were the .onions. Could also have been email. Could also have been an IP address or URI. So this certificate could be good for this URL and nothing else than this. It's very strict, but not really used that much. But you could see this. So it really boils down to what kind of certificates do we have? Do we want to have the SSL certificates? I stated SSL because a lot of companies still revert to the term SSL on the TLS. And this is typically good for websites or services. But we also have VPN certificates, personal certificates, code signing certificates, special purpose certificates like Windows domain administrative work. So if you ever become a system admin for domains, if you peel all the Microsoft layers away and you suddenly analyze this stuff with Wireshark and you deep down figure out how all these protocols of Microsoft work, suddenly you see that your entire domain administrative work is actually just another PKI system in the compounds of your company. So you have to be as careful with all the key material of your laptop authenticating to a domain controller and the domain controller stating and giving out all these certificates to all your workstations, servers, whatever, as you would with all the others, other purposes like websites and whatsoever. So pay attention to this, you'll thank me in 10 years. But so the next thing is, I want to request a certificate. How do you do this? How do you request for a certificate? I just buy one, clickety click. No, you have to communicate. At least you have to communicate the public key. So if you put everything aside, at least what you need to do for RSA encryption is have a private key. And with this private key, you generate your accompanying public key. And if you want to have a certificate with your private key and your public key being checked and verified and become slightly more, like, okay, now it should be good for websites, at least you need to communicate the public key and sign. Let this be signed by the certificate authority for this entire trust model to work. And you need to provide the naming. Well, you saw the naming convention of DigiCert basically stated, okay, this is how your names for Facebook are always constructed. And you have to figure out the technology for the public key, of course, like, are we using RSA, DSA, or any types of elliptic curve? That's a statement that you have to give out. And subject alt names. Best practices technology to use here for generating those keys is to use RSA 248-bit keys or 4096. Now, why wouldn't you just use the biggest number out there?
System load.
System load. Good students you have. Okay, system load. Yes. The thing of factoring and the thing of how this SSL connection setup works is that if you use large prime numbers like these, in some cases, it really, really is a significant burden to the server. If you calculate this, yes, modern CPUs, they're fast, so on, so on. But if you do bulk work and it adds up because you have 1,000 to 100,000 customers or something to take care of, it becomes very interesting to see what kind of hardware technology can cope with these keys. But everybody is moving towards the 4096 currently. 2048 is a bit the way to go. If you go to YouTube with a modern browser, Chrome, Firefox, whatever, you'll probably see an elliptic curve signed certificate, not RSA. Why did they do this? The keys are now 256 bits or 384 bits, so they're smaller, the calculations are easier, you don't have to work out this entire prime number stuff, and the entire setup of a connection is faster because we've used a different technology in your certificates. This means if you're Google scale, not even KPN scale, because we have a lot of services cursed out, but Google scale has a lot of huge services, like YouTube, like Gmail. They actually moved to this type of certificates to give you a faster experience, faster SSL connection setup, and less energy costs on their end. And the amount of energy costs are spread quite significant on their end, because they don't have to do all these extra calculations. Now, there is these P256 and P384s are standardized, but there are some cryptographers that have this website, safecurves.io crypto. Interesting names. And there's a huge list and research on if this one was good, bad, and why. So this is for the cryptographers to have a glance on. But if you just are not that heavily into cryptography yet, you can just see the red or green lines, and the ones who have the most green, that's good. Use that technology. That's how it boils down on that website. This is research from Tanja Lange and Dan Bernstein. They actually work in Eindhoven, so Dutch. The other best practice is that if you use an algorithm to sign anything in certificates, you should use SHA-256. This is because it's the well-known, most common, and most secure ones that we have today.
Why not SHA-3?
Very good question. Why not SHA-3? First, software adoption is low. So you end up with the situation that a lot of clients, especially the older ones, or slightly older ones, like Internet Explorer stuff, those might break because they don't have the SHA-3 in their SSL stack. So that's just usability compatibility mode. I don't even think Chrome, well, maybe Chrome does, or Chromium has. But I wonder if Firefox actually has SHA-3 support already in this. So it's mostly adoption.
How about EC?
Very good. So elliptic curve. These two curves are standardized by NIST. The one that stated the EC dual DRPG stuff, which was totally broken by the NSA and Snowden and stuff. Yes, that same standardization body also standardized this one. We do have a belief that this is not the most perfect curve that there is, but it's workable, it's safe enough to use. I've asked cryptographers as well, like, what should I use, what should I recommend to my company? And they said, well, just use this, don't use any others. Because they might be supported in OpenSSL, but not that safe. Or, which is another problem, people looked at the implementation of this one in OpenSSL and PolarSSL, but never looked on the implementation for all the other curves in equal matter, and never audited the code as much as this one. So there could be flaws, there could be another heartbleed, who knows? It's a tricky one. Worst practices, anything that goes into the 1024 bit or less, SHA-1 or Shiver Me Timbers MD5. There was a nice picture. There were two very different photos, so JPEG images, and they had the same MD5 hash, which was insane. This was the moment. Well, I already made MD5 as a no-go in our entire crypto policy. But anybody who actually thought about a solution involving MD5 somewhere, I kind of battered with a huge clue bet, like, don't even touch this technology anymore. Forget about it. It's done. It's over. It's broken. It's beyond broken. People are playing with this stuff now. It's not broken. They're playing with it like toys and then breaking it again. It's like my kids. Don't use MD5. It's bad. Did I mention it was bad? Okay. So you generate a CSR file, because this is where we were. We were generating new certificates, and you generate keys on the target station. Now, why wouldn't I do this on my laptop? Because I actually could do this on my laptop. Look, I could actually do this on my laptop. I could say, yes, Macs also have /temp. Look, a private key. Oh, looky, looky. Now what? I need to create a CSR file, for instance. Oh. My CSR files. Oh, sorry. Yeah. So one of those things is like, okay, you use a template like this to create. This is part of the homework or whatever you call it. This is a slightly tweaked version. No, this is actually the original version of what's in our of what we actually use in KPN now. It's okay, we have a default key, we set this, we want to have something in our HVA. And I ask for a lot of flags, and I want to have this. And why I put in those www.hva.nl and hva.nl is because I want to make this certificate be good for if you just type hva.nl in your browser and it, like Firefox, just sends out this request without the dot 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 in front. Okay, so I use this template, I use my private key, I said I want a new one, make a signing request, use this cutdown openssl.conf file, which is typically installed on any Linux Unix system that you have. Unix system over there, but anything on your file system that actually has OpenSSL installed, and outputs a my CSR file. So what does this look like? Well, like this, but let's reformat it. So I now requested I create a certificate signing request file, and this file should be good for the HVA, which is now suddenly in Den Haag, has 4096 bits as a public key. It's not requesting to be a CA. Could have tried it. Probably this will be flagged by the CA as, what are you doing, you idiot? It's good for anything I want. It could be a server, could be a client. It's good for those domain names and only those domain names. And I signed this one with a 256 bit SHA-256 hash. And this file, this my.csr file, I now should present this one to my CA for signature. Providing a signature on this will reformat this CSR file and create an actual certificate. There will be some processes in between, like do you own this hva.nl? Could I actually get this? And there will be some other checks, like is my credit balance actually okay enough to pay for this? So there are a lot of other checks as well that go into it. But what's the other problem? The other problem is actually the private key. The private key is on my laptop. So if I now have a website or a web service, what do I have to do? I have to transport the certificate that I get from my CA, and I have to transport the private key. Transporting, how do you transport this private key? How do you transport a file to your web server? SSH, yes. Which means any flaws in SSH or any flaws of anywhere would now suddenly compromise my private key. And I own your website if I do. Like, some people actually email this stuff. What do we do now? But I use secure email, right? I use IMAP-S. I use SMTP-S. Yes, from my laptop to the mail service. Then what happens? insecure email from the relay servers. Yes, because only if you use Google, you'll probably have the opportunity of using SSL. So now you've sent this key material, probably in the clear, to your colleague who needs to install it. Whoops, the entire internet just owns it. The GCHQ, the NSA, and all the other intelligence agencies who were just monitoring these wires now also have your private key. So basically, they can run your website. That's also a way of outsourcing. It's not recommended. Huh?
I'm told they suck at load balancing.
They suck at load balancing, yes. I always loved the NSA for not being able to handle more than 10 gigs. They want to do covert operations. So I blow them away. Well, I mean, the NSA are nice guys, they're very intelligent, but they're not my intelligence agency, so get the fuck out. That's an official KPN statement, but not quotable. It's a recorded, huh? Shit. Cut this one out. Sorry, boss. Okay. This is your official statement already from KPN. Get the fuck out, is basically what we want to say. It's actually my manager saying it in slightly more political terms. Okay, she's not really that political, sorry. That's true. You generate the keys on the target station, no transport needed. The CSR files, basically the thing is you could forge those keys into even hardware security modules, so tamper-proof safes, whatever how you would call it, thumb drives that are specially equipped only for to storing cryptographic material. Your website or your if you have a simple website, a web shop, whatever, okay, you can just store this on disk and take care of file permissions. If you have the Department of Defense as a customer, you basically work with hardware security modules. Yes, we work with that stuff as well. You really need it. Do take care that you have a true random number generator, as we've just seen. Those are very important, because otherwise the keys that you generate could be similar to what happened to Debian quite some years ago. They had a compiler bug. They saw some compiler warnings and they were just, oh shit, OpenSSL is not compiling properly, what the hell, it's reading random memory, what the hell. Let's fix this. And they fixed 32 bits of very good entropy by setting it to zero. Wait a minute, zero was very predictable, right? So now they made the random function pretty darn bad, really bad. There's now just code in ssllabs.com, which is from Qualys, and it actually checks your certificate if you were generated by one of those Debian flawed systems at the time to see if your key could be compromised very easily. This number was chosen by a fair roll of dice. Even if you have a dice of 12 sides or more, it still becomes a bit of an issue. So yeah, be careful with your random functions. They are very fundamental to your cryptography. The output is in the format of a PKCS 10 file. This is the CSR file just shown. Signed by a private key, protected therefore by a private key with respect to manipulation. Procedural, you really have to think about, just don't even think about or try to even change your processes just to figure out if you could find a way of not sending the private key anywhere in the entire process. I work at a big company and they, in some cases they do this nice and fine, but in some cases, well, unfortunately, they really have to transfer data from one air-gapped machine to another. And in that case, we really have already other means of using encrypted USB sticks to transfer it over to another site and then move up, just to ensure that somewhere we couldn't really make a mistake with private keys. And the other thing is, of course, try to encrypt your private key if you can. which is very hard to do if you just want to reboot your server and just pop once you want to have your website back again. It's interesting catch 22. Okay, so you upload this one to your registration authority page for CA. You upload this file, you wait for approval, and you download it. But it's nice that you created your CSR file as delicately as you were, as you tried to do. But eventually there's this policy of the big bad CA, or big CA or whatever, and they will just change the way on how they actually write everything in your certificate. But foremost, they will check your request. They will try to figure out who you are. Are you actually obliged to apply for this? If you go for a PKI Overheid certificate, they really want to see you in person at least once in the entire process. You can get your second request based on the fact that they already authenticated you and checked you out with your identity card the first time. So this is not the same thing as just clickety-click and now I have a GoDaddy certificate. Yippee. Because you just paid with your credit card. But again, even in those cases, you have a check not just on your credit balance, but also your identity on the credit card. And if this matches the ownership of the DNS records, for instance, that are going into the certificate. Because you get a certified statement from them that you own this DNS record. So what is a common thing for the IP addresses and DNS records is they do a whois lookup on the registration or administrative or technical contact, call them, email them, whatever, and then you can get access to this then you can go on with the process of applying for a certificate, and then you have the opportunity of course for in-person checks. So the actual CA behind the registration desk, portal, website, whatever, creates this certificate from the CSR file and signs it with its private key. This is done in these kinds of machines. So this is, yes, you could do this in OpenSSL command on the command line tool, but this is the typical stuff that you would see. SafeNet, Lunas, or another company. You see different FOBs. This means it has different roles to oblige to. So there would be a separate administrator to administer this device. There would be a guy being able to hook up this on the network. Somebody who can only do updates on this device, but never touch all the private keys or anything else that is guarded within this device in a tamper-proof container on the inside of this slightly tamper-proof box. So if you open up this box, you can see hardware security modules. It's like PCMCIA cards. Don't know if you know what that technology is, but it's back in my days we had other cards that go into slots, and if you try to break those open, they will break on the inside. So they have like epoxy on the inside or anything else, which is a like a glue, and if you try to open this up, it basically means the chip should break that contains the key material. This is what you try to guard in that sense. You had a question?
Yeah, do end clients need to know the private key of CAs?
No, never. No. I was thinking about a very interesting edge case. As client of a CA, I do want to know if my CA actually stores its private key in these kinds of devices. Do they protect it like this? If I sometimes I need to go into the company and ask, like, okay, what kind of certificates do you use? Do you use any interesting certificates? And for what do you use it? For testing networks, bigger networks whatsoever? And they say, we built our own CA. Shotgun, it's ready. And how do you guard your private key? It's the first question I ask. If they don't say they use stuff like this, or they trust a big CA, or they have smaller hardware security modules, basically they're done and can just rebuild this part of the infrastructure. Because the entire trust model resides on the fact that the private keys of the ones that sign this stuff are well guarded and only work for signing these CSR files from within this container. So what happens with these CSR files is they are uploaded near this device. The device sucks it in. There's a procedure, sometimes an automated procedure, sometimes a manual procedure, depends. Then it goes through the HSM modules, through an API, and out comes the certificate. So the private key never touches daylight. There's never a moment that it touches a shell or anything else.
And how do I verify the CA that the certificate?
Now that has to do with how the private key and the public key basically work together, and how these mathematical relationship resides between the private key and the public key, which was in the beginning of the presentation. Okay, so the CA is authoritative. They can overrule anything in your CSR file except for the public key, because otherwise it wouldn't make sense, because the public key is part of your private key. They follow a template of how to create this. They follow their own stated guidelines, like, okay, I do this flag, not this one. They eventually select the hash algorithm, and these days they would end up with SHA-2 algorithms mostly, because otherwise you get errors in your Chrome browser. The end certificates is what we were talking about just yet. Those are issued by an issuing CA. And what you could typically see is that there is an intermediate CA and a root CA that signs each of these levels. So an end certificate, end entity certificate, is signed by the issuing CA, and the issuing CA was signed by the other one, and which was signed by the root CA, the only one which is really self-signed. But there could be more structured hierarchies. And why would this be? If you want to give out certificates with a certain policy for humans, it would be a different policy than for machines, or machine-to-machine interaction, or for VPNs, or for websites. It would be different. And what they could do now is change the policy bit by bit and assigned to each of these CAs. And by making this change, or if there's a compromise, or there's a change of policy, they can just say, okay, well, we stop with this one because we only use old SHA-1 or even MD5 hashing algorithms here, and we peel down and just use the root CA only. This is how they try to structure this, because it's very hard to change any of these CA structures. Why wouldn't I just use one root CA and then just sign everything from there? Well, one is scale, one is the policies, single point of failure. So you don't really want to touch that. So what you really want to do is just be able to cut off a branch that is not working properly enough, or you really want to stop with using that branch. But what happens here is, of course, that these root CAs cannot just roll over overnight. It takes a very long process, because they're in the Linux, Windows, OS X, BSD, Firefox, Opera, who have their own databases of root CAs. And this is basically what you see in root CAs. So where are those root CAs? If you go to Firefox, of course the preferences, if you're not using a Mac, is in a different location. Oops. And you've got your settings, your advanced, and in the certificates you have here view certificates. And you can see my personal certificate, so this is my client certificate. and you really want to look at the authorities. And here we see interesting authorities like which you implicitly trust. These are authorities that your browser implicitly trusts when you go into a website. They get all the certificates, and it will use this one or any of the other ones in the list. So which Chamber of Commerce for some kind of company, AdTrust, what the hell's AdTrust? America Online still exists. Something with Baltimore. Ah, yeah, this is from Microsoft themselves. This is mine. It's my private root CA for my own cloud stuff. China Internet Network Information Center. Interesting. What else do we have for funny situations? Cyber Trust, DTrust, which is. Right. What the f- I have to dig down very deeply, like, what the hell has happened here? Yeah, well, it could be my daughter, but she's only 5. Then again, they grow up pretty quickly. So, okay, GeoTrust, Global Sign, GoDaddy, shoot some elephants, yes, and Hong Kong Post Office, yeah, it's for the people who do stuff with Deal Extreme and so on. Hong Kong Post Office, very important. What else do we have? Portswigger. Anybody know Portswigger? Shut up. What? Burp Suite? Oh. Write down Burp Suite. Have fun and enjoy the ride. It's part of the assignment even to investigate on the uses of this and why I have this here. Some other root CA, what else do we have? La 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 la, Sonera. Oh, Staat en Nederlander. Now this one is interesting. So, there are two routes for Staat en Nederlander CA. The G2, Generation 2 is the one in effect, and which signs a lot of other CAs. And one of them that, well, at least we use, I mean, we don't have the Quo Vadis, this is another company. KPN Corporate Market is one of the other CAs. And this is used for a lot of websites that have to do with, think of DigiD, think of National Cybersecurity Center, think of, I don't know what, all kinds of government agencies, the Belastingdienst, everything uses this. So, bear in mind, this is what the problem is with PKI. The problem of PKI is that you have to validate all the certificates to your certificate that you use on your website. Your clients need to trust the root CA that you just used. Which one did you use? Did you use the Terena one? Did you use the User Trust? Did you use the AdTrust? Did you use the GoDaddy? Did you use the Turk Trust? Did you use the Staat en Nederlander root CA? You don't know. So the clients don't know. So the clients trust all. So if any of these make a mistake, like DigiNotar did, you just have, well, pretty heavy problem because everybody already trusts these kinds of companies. You have this trust already. You have an implicit trust on all this stuff from VeriSign. And Visa. And Wells Fargo. Yeah, this one is. So, if any of these get hacked, I think it was one of those Turk Trust stuff was hacked, and the DigiNotar is not in there anymore.
Komodo is.
Huh?
Komodo is.
Yeah, but the Komodo still is, which was a bit on doubt, like how far did they get and did they actually... Anywho. So, okay, we've got this entire list of of okay, I have a certificate here, and I've got the root CA certificates that I've already have installed on my browser. End certificate, root certificate, intermediates. What the hell? If this one is signed by this one, and this one is signed by this one, and I have this, and I could verify all these signatures, how the hell does this boil down to this? The solution is the sub-CA distribution. So when you submit a, when you run a site, you always have to install a bundle file with this. If anybody who has a website, you'll see what I mean, and I will demonstrate it. And what you need to distribute as well with your host certificate is all the sub-CAs that were the intermediate link between the root CA and the end entity certificate. And your SSL stack will ignore the root CA if you actually pass this as well. So what this means is if you connect to this random website, you'll get the host certificate and you'll get the intermediate certificate from this site. Tiny demo time. Now we can use the Facebook one as well, but now minus show certs, the extra subcommand here. But okay, this one certificate, two certificates. What the hell is this? Yes. So magic. Lower font size. You can see it more clearly. So here's a gap. So this is the star.facebook.com certificate. And the other certificate is the DigiCert High Assurance CA3 certificate, which was signed by the High Assurance EV root CA. So the actual root CA was not sent.
No, it says issued.
Sorry? Yeah, so this is the intermediate. Yeah, okay. So okay, this one, so the actual certificate is issued by this intermediate, and the intermediate is this one. See, it's S for subject, I for issued. So this one got signed by the actual root CA. And I get an OK. Because my OpenSSL is distributed by Mac, which is hacked by Apple. Thanks. Hooked up to my keychain, and I already have my CA cert stuff. Because typically on your Linux systems, you have to add the minus CA path directive to get an OK. And this is because in that directory, SSL, I have a huge list of all the certificates or all the root CAs that you just saw in my Firefox. I also have them on disk. So this is how my OpenSSL verifies this. So based on this, actually I have a pointer. So based on this, I have a host certificate and I've got the intermediate CA distributed from the site. My browser has the root and now I have the complete chain, and now the entire SSL stack can now verify this certificate and verify this certificate to be totally cool. But it doesn't end there. Because there's also something that's called certificate revocation lists and online certificate status protocol. In the certificates, also known as CRLs and OCSP, in the protocol, so the certificates are valid for 1 year or 3 years. But what if I got hacked on the first year and my certificate is valid for 3? How do my clients know that I was hacked and this certificate is actually worthless because it's completely compromised by the hacker? You could send a message to your CA and they will add your serial number to their revocation list. This is a file which, well, there's these CRL endpoints are just stated in each and every certificate. And with this, you can get a file downloaded from the CA. It can be cached by your browser or anything else that you use. And it could check if the serial number of your SSL connection or your TLS connection is in this list, it means it's blacklisted, it's flawed, it's hacked, don't trust it, error, stop, halt. So in some cases when sites got hacked, it is interesting to see that there were, unfortunately I don't have a screenshot for that. Those are blacklisted, and then you see a very red chrome background, like this is a hacked website, don't even think about continuing. Are you really, really sure? I hope you are a researcher or something like that. So that's the type of error messages that you get out of. These files are signed, typically valid for roughly a month to 2 weeks. Then you need to refresh them. So here's an example of a CRL file, and it's signed, it's stated, okay, the Quo Vadis CA for grid computing quite some years ago. This is the version of the CRL number, blah, blah, blah. And it also mentions sometimes the reason why this certificate was revoked. And this is why I took this one, because they actually mentioned it like key compromised. Okay, so somebody's box kind of got hacked around this date. And key compromised. It could be a hack. I'd like to think this guy's box got hacked, but it doesn't have to be. Because if you just transported your private key through email, or you've transported your private key through SSH, if you go through very strict norms, like I'd like to go through, then typically that transfer, without any other safeguards, is already a key compromise. So it could be a procedural compromise, not an actual I got hacked compromise. But I like to think about this one got hacked. There's also another statement like superseded. This means, okay, the certificate that I now have got superseded by a new one because I lost the private key. Could also happen. So that would be from an idiot. Could all happen. OCSP is a client-server protocol. Yeah.
What is the difference between sending a private key file and just opening private key in VI via SSH? Because isn't that
I don't do that, so
okay.
It's like I have this key there. Don't touch.
I've seen a lot of people generate private keys and open it to see, did it work? Oh, it worked. Okay, let's close it again.
Yeah. Yeah, I've done that too in the past though, but I try to stop myself of doing those things. Typically I do trust my SSH connections pretty much to even do this. The problem is that if you have even more safeguard requirements based on the type of clients that you work for or customers or whatever, and they really want to have this assurance that you don't make these kinds of look and see moments, then you should even move to HSMs, where the HSM says, yes, green, you've gotten a private key and it's this long. It's good, trust it. And then you can move and you can verify that you trust that it's good by checking the key and doing some analysis based on the certificate that you have. Because with the certificate you can check if the private key actually fits and belongs to that one. You didn't make a mistake.
Best practice to manufacture.
Best practice, never touch it. If you need to, okay. So there are two competing protocols. One is the traditional one, and there's a more modern one. This one was created for high volume situations, which is typically the norm on the internet now. You send a serial number to an OCSP server. So it's not just get a file or whatever, you really have to get or post a serial number to it, and you get in response a signed message like, okay, this one is good, is revoked or unknown. It's good, that's the typical answer that you hope for. It's revoked, Well, there could be a reason motivating the revocation, and unknown is a bit dodgy because this means you just asked for the status of a serial number that the CA should have issued but doesn't know about. It's an odd case. Do remember for the for one of the case studies. One of the other reasons that one of the reasons that you could specify here is, well, it's unspecified or key compromise, CA compromised. Did you notar happened a while back? That's when the CA compromised flag went up. Affiliation change, so some guy left the company. Superseded, well, some whatever motivation. Cessation of operation, well, sometimes it's a bit critical to me, like, what the hell do you mean with this? Because it's not really documented what you mean by this statement. Cessation of operation typically means that you've cut off an intermediate CA and it doesn't really work anymore. But typically you wouldn't have a certificate that's valid to even check for this, so it's a bit odd to have this statement in the standard. Certificate on hold, no idea what the hell, this could be a procedural motivation or remove from CRO. Well, I would suggest a break now. Let's say for a maximum of 10 minutes, just to refresh your brain, get a drink, get back. See you in 10. Is die deur dicht? Nee. Dankjewel. We have to go deeper. Klik. Oké, nog even een klein resume. Dus hoe zit de stack nou in elkaar totdat we dus op HTTP uitkomen? We hebben, oh ja, Engels hè? Switch. Okay, so how does the stack, what does the stack look like? The stack of layered protocols. We have a connection between a random computer and a very old Cray supercomputer. Using TCP/IP or UDP. Doesn't really care if you use TCP or UDP. You have the TLS handshake protocol. You negotiate keys to be used for your session encryption, and then you can send application data encrypted over this connection that you have, and the encrypted data would be HTTP, for instance, for example. The entire protocol looks like this. You have your connection, your UDP or TCP/IP connection established. And the first thing that you send is a client hello message to the server, and the server replies with a server hello, and sometimes, or most oftenly, because it fits within the record or within an TLS record, it would fit to send a server certificate accompanied with the server hello. If you use the feature or have this enabled, like if you use a modern Apache or Nginx installation or HAProxy, I don't think that has new ones, then you could also send an OCSP stapled message in return, like what is the status of this certificate as a statement from the CA, but now cached by the website. You can push that too. There's a star there. This means it's an optional message. So if there's a wildcard, a star, this means it's an optional message. Optionally, you could send a server key exchange, and you could send a client certificate request. And this means a client would need to authenticate with its certificate. So my personal, my company card certificate or anything else could also be requested, yes, no, optionally, from the server side. And depending on where you are, this would then send a server hello done. I'm done with the hello stuff. A client could then optionally send over its certificate. Like, I want to also authenticate myself to the server. The server is not just sending its identity communicated by the client, sorry, by the certificate. From the server, you can now also identify yourself to the server, you send a client key exchange message, you can state a certificate verify message, a change cipher spec, and an encrypted handshake message. And all this could then be followed up by optionally a new session ticket. It's an optional thing, like, okay, if you return back and you send this ticket, you can resume the SSL TLS connection. You can communicate, and the server could communicate and state, okay, we're gonna change indeed the cipher specification to whatever we just agreed upon. And it sends the encrypted handshake message in return. The client says I'm finished, the server says I'm finished. Okay. This is basically all the steps that would go into a TLS handshake, and then we can start communicating the application. I will go into detail on what this really means from a Wireshark perspective soon. But one thing to remember is the client, the server name initiator. Does everybody know what virtual hosting is? Does anybody, who doesn't? Just for the short intro. Virtual hosting, okay. If you have one IP address, I could just serve, and you send an HTTP GET request to it, I could just serve you the web page. But IP addresses are scarce. We only have 4 billion of these. For IPv4 at least, and we're still in an IPv4 world, unfortunately. And a lot of hosting companies really want to have a lot of websites reside on the same server IP address or serve from the same server. So how do we deal with this? You send a GET request and you send host as a host initiator statement, and you state I want the website for www.kpn.com or login.kpn.com, and then get a different site served because now you just want to do the login. This is how the server can discriminate. But if you use an SSL connection, I used a plain text protocol to make this discrimination. But now I have an encrypted protocol that is now encrypting the HTTP data that does this discrimination. Should I give you this page or the other page? I just encrypted this. So what now needs to happen is, yeah, okay, you cannot make this discrimination anymore on this site. So what you need to do is within the SSL handshake, in the client hello message, you give a statement, the server name initiator, a server name, and you state there, I want to have the www.kpn.com site or the login. So now, before you even start the SSL handshake, you already need to create this discrimination, because now you get served perhaps a different certificate or anything else. Tiny demo. What do I mean with this? This time I won't take this. I take my own website. So if I just go to, so on the top line you can see, well, I hope you can see it in the back, everybody. I don't know if you can see the top line. There. I went to my own website, port 443, but now this is something with own cloud. I don't know if anybody knows what the hell this is. Yes. And card dev and CalDev and everything. So it's my own cloud, yes. Okay, so signed by my own root CA, which you already saw in my other stuff. But I went to oscar.kuro.net, and this certificate here on the top line is only good for cloud.kuro.net and base.kuro.net. Now, how the hell did this work when I went to Oscar? So what happens is if I now state I want to have this mile boiled down into a mistake server name. No underscore. I always make this mistake. Now suddenly, I went to the same site, same IP address, but now with this certificate, and this certificate on the top line, you can see it's from my actual website that I'm into. So what happened? The server name indicator was blank first, and just gave a default page from my Nginx configuration. But I have an explicit SSL configuration for vHosting, a virtual hosting, paid for my own normal website, the oscar.kuro.net. And because I now stated explicitly, I want to go to this URL, to this name, to this DNS record, Nginx knows, in the client hello, you just specified oscar.kuro.net and not the own cloud stuff. You made it very explicit. Now you get a different certificate, and now I also get a different TLS SSL cipher suite combination with encryption technology suited for this and not suited for exactly or specified towards my smartphones. This is how you can play with these configurations and virtual hosting, also in SSL. So the important detail is on one IP address, you could still host multiple SSL TLS certificates and sites, just like you would with the normal way of without using SSL. Now, why do I make this so explicit? A lot of people don't really believe that this actually works, but this is what what Chrome, Firefox, and Internet Explorer 8 and 7 and whatever already supports for roughly 8 years. But not everybody is acquainted with it. Here we have a client hello message. So this is the SSL the TLS v1 record for the client hello. It specifies I only want to work with TLS 1.0. It says something about random bytes, and it specifies which cipher suites I support from the client side. So this states what kind of encryption technology does my browser support. You have 76 options and combinations there. And some of them might be really bad. If you have an old browser, think of support for SSL v3, for instance, pool attack, or more recently Freak, where there could be very ancient 1990s quality export ciphers, which was in the news last week, which is called the Freak attack. It's where the ciphers are normally encryptions with 256-bit or 128-bit AES encryption, but the Freak attack demonstrated that some clients still silently support 40-bit or less. 40-bit, this really means you can basically crack it on my laptop in just a few minutes. That's really bad. It's good for me. It's bad for security. Okay, so we have the client hello, and here is the server hello. It replied, also gave me some random bytes, and it selected out of all the combinations that were out there. And yes, this is unfortunately, this is the kpn.com website. It selected RC4 128 bits MD5. Out of all the things, this actually got selected. The thing is that, yes, it's not that bad, but it is compatible. So now we can start and set up the encryption based on just this. The other message that I have from the server hello is here the certificate, and here you can see some of the details, www.kpn.com and wherever it came from. Lekker luidruchtig hier. Yeah. Another message that got sent back is the client key exchange, and which is the pre-master secret. This is essentially a random byte, set of random bytes sent from the client from my browser to the server, and this is what's used to actually set up the symmetric encryption technology. So why don't we use RSA, for instance, and we use this entire change of cipher spec message here? Any ideas on why we change cipher specs? Well, you hold the phone. Message here. Okay, so RSA encryption with this public and private key stuff is very expensive to the CPU, and all the messages need to go through this algorithm byte by byte, which is very CPU intensive. And what you want to use is stuff like AES, which could either be a block or a stream cipher, and move lots of bytes through your CPU in a very simple and elegant way. So an AES encryption is very, well, not that heavy for the CPU, and you can really move lots of bytes into gigabytes per second through a CPU without hardware accelerated tools or something else. So that's why you need to do this changeover, but you have to tie the authenticity of the certificate to the symmetric key that you now are going to use for the AES encryption. And this is why the client is cooking up a pre-master key, which is now used for the next step. And the next step would be that you create a master key, and the master keys are exchanged between the peers, and now we have a read and a write symmetric key negotiated between the client and the server, and now we can start with the entire encryption. The weakest link, obviously, is what always breaks the entire stuff. So, pre-master key, it's generated by the client. The session keys are derived by the pre-master key. The client encrypts a pre-master key with the server's public key. So it's encrypted. So we have a one-step encryption there with this key. And it's encrypted with the public key. So on my client side, I have the public key of the server, and now I encrypt it. And only the server could use or decrypt it with the private key, right? So now we have client and server both generate the master key for this session for the read and write. And we can actually just simply deduce already that if we expose the private key accidentally, all the encryption and all the encrypted sessions could be decrypted. Now, why is this? It's because the technology that we used here, the technique, is the RSA the RSA key exchange. It's not so much not that optimal and best symmetric key. It's the way how we communicate the keys and negotiate the keys. Because of this technique, we have this little incident from a few years back now. Does anybody know what Lavabit was? You don't get to choose. Okay, they were running in a secure email service. Do we know who was the most interesting client there? Mr. Snowden. Mr. Snowden used the Lavabit as encryption. So what they did is they stored all the mails very securely. They transported each of these very securely, need to make a changeover, and then it's encrypted on disk. Fine, nice. But they got a subpoena by the NSA because of what Snowden did and because of the research towards him. So what happened is that they asked for the private key of Lavabit. It's just that if you use this technology, all the sessions and all the master keys of each session were basically decryptable by the private key, this one private key, which is typically valid for a year. So it would be in operation for a year. And with this technique, it's always this key. So if you, as an NSA organization, record all the data going in and out of LavaBit for a year, you ask then eventually for the private key after many years, or maybe just a half a year later, you can decrypt all the sessions that ever went past this if you did not use perfect forward secrecy.
What do you mean, ask?
Sorry? It's a politely political statement, like they demand the key. You will deliver the key. Sorry. So LavaBit didn't really have an opportunity to say no. So the LavaBit owner printed it in font size 6 or something like that. Very stack of papers, like, okay, here's my private key. So he delivered and he shut down. There is a way of beating the NSA by using cryptographic technology, which is perfect forward secrecy. One of the techniques that's used here is ephemeral Diffie-Hellman, also known as EDH or DHE, depending on how you wish to write it. And ephemeral means it's only lasting for a certain period of time. According to the Greek stuff, it's one day. But the thing is, the takeaway is it's only used for a session and then it vanishes. So it's also called Diffie-Hellman Merkle key exchange. Merkle is a brilliant guy, never really mentioned anywhere. Merkle also created, or at least the technology used in Bitcoins had to do with cryptographic work from Merkle. The thing is that the public and the private keys of the server are now not just used for encrypting and decrypting these session keys, but are only used to authenticate the integrity of the material used to generate these session keys. And they talk about the base generator modulus, so I will not go into the math of that detail. But the takeaway is that session keys are not derived from the keys in the certificates that you could just subpoena for. The FBI could just enter your building and ask for them. Or the AIVD or any other body in the Netherlands as well could just ask for the keys or demand you deliver the keys. It's just that if you do this, all the customers, and not just Snowden, on your server would be compromised now with all their privacy and integrity and whatever. This is what we call sleepnet or dragnet surveillance, which is a bad thing because it should be targeted. So Diffie-Hellman key exchange, what the hell? How does this work? Very simple schematic. We use paint, not paint.exe, but just actual paint. And the assumption here is that if you make a mixture of paint, then you can make the new color, but it's very labor intensive, CPU intensive to reverse this process. So you have a common painting color, you have a secret color, and you have a secret, you have a public way of transporting them from A to B. You can do this over the regular internet, but you've mixed them, and you only communicate the mixed colors to each other. And then you combine the privates of your own and the mixed colors, and you end up with a common secret. It's math explained very simply on how that one works. So what you would do is you generate a common painting color, a common key. You create a secret key, and this one you keep to yourself. You mix them. You communicate the mixed versions of these, and with your own still held on privately colors, you can now communicate using the eventually combined key. So you now generated, just for one session, you created a common secret key. Yeah.
This will only work if you generate a new secret color for every session.
Yes.
And throw it away as soon as the session is gone. So it cannot be retrieved by the NSA or anybody, right?
Yes.
And you want to repeat the recording?
So for the report, for the recording, this is really just meant and only works well if you only use this key and this this method per session. So after the session, you should throw away the keys, really burn it, make sure that it is wiped from memory from the software that just used it even, and generate unique keys per new session. So the downside is that if you work with load balancers, if you work with software stacks and you have high volume traffic, you really have to figure out which of the Diffie-Hellman ephemeral opportunities you have, elliptic curve versions versus the traditional version, which ones you really could use. Because if you have high volume traffic and you have a lot of sessions to go through, it becomes very CPU intensive, because it needs to generate random keys continuously. It needs to set up some extra stuff per session now, compared to the traditional way. So suddenly, server key exchange is now not optional, but now used in the entire protocol, because now you send an extra bit of key material you need to communicate from the server back to the client, and not just from the client only to the server. And this is what we see here. Here we see the just the client hello. It happens to be that this is a TLS 1.2 session. Isn't really important. The detail is, of course, that we have the same set of cipher suites to communicate with. For the very observant user or the looker here, this has 47 suites instead of the 72 in the previous slide. So this is a different client. Yes, you can also profile clients based on what they support. The server hello communicates the same kind of details back again, the selection of the encryption, which is now elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman ephemeral RSA with AES 256 CBC SHA-384, sorry. And the extension to this is now that we have elliptic curve points and other data that has to do with the setup of the elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman ephemeral key exchange, the session key exchange. And that's how you can spot the difference already. And then you see there's a certificate. In this case, it's a certificate for an organization called Operation Cyberpaint. And then we finish, and here the server key exchange sends the key material back from the server. And now we have, this is effectively sending over the colored, or the public color, mixed color from the server side back to the client again. And now both ends can now have sufficient information to create this common secret. And they can communicate that they actually moved over to this secret with the client key exchange, and then they're done. Okay. So we've now set up a TLS connection. But what actually goes in to my browser just accepting the certificate? I mean, we now have a key exchange explained, but we still have the step of the certificate checks to explain. Because we know what goes into a certificate, all kinds of parameters and all kinds of data. We now have the keys exchanged for the TLS connection. But okay, I now have a valid certificate. Is this it? No, there are more steps to this, because it wouldn't be that much fun without it. So, certificates can be used in different protocols and different clients and servers need to do different checks. So there are specific RFCs for SMTP, EAP, TLS, 802.11, stuff which is used for Eduroam, for instance. There's a different specification for HTTP, And there's a different specification for all kinds of other things like XMPP or SIP. SIP for VoIP calls, which is all of them are different. But the common denominator is what you really want to do is you bind the identity of the certificate, exposed and stated by the certificate. You want to bind it with the TCP IP or UDP session that you've just set up. That's the goal, because I have a connection and I really want to know who is on the other side of the connection, because okay, we can now do secure connection, we have the authenticity, we have the confidentiality stuff, we've got that part covered. Also the integrity checks are covered, but the authenticity is still to be checked. Am I really talking to the guy that I really think, or is this the bank that I really wish to connect to? So okay, step one, you've got your TCP IP handshake, you remember the URL that you went to, www.kpn.com or www.hva.nl. You connect, you should see this as an end result. But the second stage is, okay, you've now received the entire certificate chain, up to and including the root certificate sometimes. At least you have the root certificate already pre-installed in your browser. You combine it with all the intermediate CAs. You combine it with the host certificate. And then you can conclude at least that this certificate chain is fully valid, based on the fact that you fully trust all those root CAs in your browser. The Turk Trust and so on. And the Hong Kong Post Office. You then check the validity of the certificate. Is this one still valid, or did Facebook forget to renew the certificate on their main page? Who knows? I would definitely set a timer and have a laugh on Twitter in a few days. So this is a time-based check, and there's of course the revocation check, which we also gotten into. So your browser can send a request to the OCSP responder, or check the CRL, grab the file, check is the serial number revoked, yes or no, then move on to the next stage. So these are parameters that you can figure out, like okay, this one is expired, 2014 September, so this is an old slide. If you check, the website is good today. So, with respect to the OCSP request stuff, if you see a revoked, kill the connection, because this one got hacked. If it's unknown, it depends on the client on what they do. Firefox typically had the let's help the user connect, because I don't know what the hell to do with unresponsive or bad behaving OCSP responders. And went through and just said, okay, whatever, I don't know what's going on, here's the connection, I'll see it next time. The other opportunity is to download the CRL file from the CA, check it, if your serial number of the certificate is in the list, kill it. Or the other option is built-in fingerprints, white or blacklist. Do we know a browser? Does anybody of you would like to pitch a browser that actually uses this one? The built-in fingerprints. Pick a random browser.
Chrome does certificate
thing,
so.
Chrome is the one that actually, because Google knows how their own infrastructure is working, they actually whitelisted all the certificates that they are in control of. So what they did is all the certificates that they know of are listed not just by the fact that all these checks are fine and okay, but they just push information in the source code of Chrome. And with that, they can do a fingerprint check based on the public key or other details of the entire certificate. And this is how they verify if a link is compromised, or this is why they are sometimes in the news faster than all the other browsers and companies for spotting abusive regimes that try to intercept the TLS connections to Google or Gmail or YouTube. based on the fact that on the border of their country, they have intercept TLS SSL intercept tools installed. Like in Iran, in Syria, and Tunisia had it as well, in Egypt. In China, of course. That's how they check how they control the population. We continue with the last part, and that is we check the subject alt names list and match them based on DNS, URI, or maybe IP address, depending on the client, against the URL that we just remembered in the first place. This is the binding connection for the entire RFC. It basically states, okay, if you really wanted to connect to that site, you should expect a certificate that states, I'm good for this site, and not just a random valid certificate, but because it could have been my personal certificate or something else, intercepting your TLS connection handshake. And if you see a warning message on your browser, it says, well, this is a valid certificate. Chrome is very helpful in this sense. This is a valid certificate, but it's not for your website. What to do? It asks you what to do. If you click continue, it could be that somebody with a pineapple or any other hack Wi-Fi intercepting tool would just be in your vicinity, catching your connection, intercepting everything that goes, well, where you just accept it for. And if you just accept this once, this decision is sometimes cached in your browser until you reconnect or reload the browser. Thus, any other connection that basically goes through, I don't know, my little valid certificate, like Ahmed's kebab shop and whatever CA or something that authorized any certificate, that would eventually make you vulnerable to me or anybody else who pulls this stunt. You can find these if you just scroll down to the extra information for all the certificates. You can scroll down and you can see that this is good for m.kpn.com. This is a mobile website view. kpn.com, mijnkpn.com, inloggen.kpn.com, accounts, zakelijk, and www.kpn.com. This is where this certificate is good for, and installed on a load balancer. And then there's Google. So not all the Google sites actually serve this certificate, but some of them did. And this one is good for wildcard.google.com, wildcard.android.com, App Engine, Cloud, Cloud CA, all kinds of country codes, differences, Google API.china, Google Commerce, GStatic, YouTube-nocookie.com, what the hell? YouTube education, blah, 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 and the list went on, as you can see. So this certificate is very powerful. I love these kinds of certificates, because if I get the opportunity to, which would be very unethical, but if I would get a hold of this, of the private key of this certificate, I could recreate the rest of the certificates out of that. And yeah, from that private key, I could now intercept any of those in the list. This means if a country would want to look at what their citizens are doing, this would be an ideal spot to hack, because it's that powerful and because it's good for everything. What I always recommend is just chop it down to just whatever sites you really want the certificate to work for, and nothing more, nothing less. Because otherwise, these certificates are getting too, well, quote-unquote, powerful. If one gets hacked, the entire infrastructure gets hacked as well. Or interceptable. So, obviously, we know that we should trust DNS to connect you to the right IP address. This could be dodgy, I mean, there are BGP attacks, there are DNS attacks, not everybody has DNSSEC installed. The CA must check if this certificate owner is indeed claiming the actual ownership of these DNS records, so there's a lot of dodgy things here, and could all be manipulated in the entire process. But the most important thing is like, okay, the easiest thing for you guys to figure or to solve is that as system administrator, you must never leak the private key, because that could make anybody else also possible to claim ownership of that certificate, which was already public. Self-signed certificates. The root CA is a self-signed certificate, but well-guarded processes, checks, balances, whatsoever. You could create your own self-signed certificate. The problem is of self-signed certificates and using that on your website is that all the information that you wish to trust your entire connection upon is now signed by you and just yourself. So there's no third party that actually checked if all the data is good or not. And all the SSL connections and all the SSL libraries are acquainted with the fact that you have a PKI environment with a CA, and the CA issued a certificate, and if you want to check this host certificate, you want to trust this CA or this entire chain of CAs. If you cannot do this, basically this is a blank. This is a, well, worthless certificate to use. The only thing that could save you is certificate pinning, is that if you have an out-of-band or an out-of-band connection or whatever to the other side that says, okay, all the clients need to explicitly expect this self-signed, self-forged certificate. If you use SSH, for instance, you see there's a different model. We still have RSA and DSA and elliptic curve keys, but the model is different. The trust model there is based upon the check on the fingerprints. If the fingerprints change and you didn't expect this change, this would be equivalent to using a self-signed certificate and that the pinning feature failed. This is the fingerprint check in SSH. But this is not how certificates work, but the problem, because the thing is, okay, my mother now needs to figure out if the fingerprint change is a good or a bad thing. She cannot make this decision. So, and this is why we have PKI, because now we have other bodies and other measures to actually make this check. HSTS. I wouldn't go too deep into this one, because this basically means HTTPS or get the fuck out. What does that mean? It means that it's a header in HTTP. If you made a connection to HTTPS site ever, and you get this in return, let's take it the other way. If you wouldn't set it or wouldn't use it, you would just go to the website. You would do a normal, plain text HTTPS request, and this is what you can see here. Yeah, and this bit over here, this is the actual GET request. I get it over HTTP, I get a reply, and then we start talking HTTPS suddenly. Because the reply here is a 301 move permanently. Now why is this so flawed? What could happen? What could possibly go wrong? Any suggestions? Yes.
Plain text, so if you were in the middle, you could change the redirect to other place, like one of your servers.
Ding, correct. If you have a man-in-the-middle attack in the plain text, like this, in HTTP, you could serve a completely different page or do something completely different as a reply, because attackers are in full control of this. Nice. This is how the internet works. This is basically if you type the www.idontknowwhat and it needs to move to a secure site, this attack could just hit you on any Wi-Fi spot that you are located in. This can be prevented by using HSTS. It's a first time write and then always connect over SSL continuously. What would happen is that normally you would go to the go to a homepage on HTTP, you get bounced to HTTPS, and with the HTTPS you can now move about and blah blah blah, and you can move on. Okay, yes, you can even move back to HTTP, which is also a huge risk, because now the session ID could be exposed as well. So what you want is the other move, is you go to the HTTP site, and the first time you get a statement, you get a reply back with the HSTS policy, like use for the next coming 3 months exclusively use HTTPS and only HTTPS from your browser. So if you type in without HTTPS www.website.com and you have this in your cache, it will directly connect to HTTPS. Doesn't even pass the normal HTTP runaround and connect directly to HTTPS, which is nice, because it even if you then move back from HTTPS to a normal HTTP site, due to I don't know what this library of code would do, because it could just happen, that you're even safeguarded for this this bug, that somewhere along the lines you would be set back to HTTP and still be interceptable for credit card information or session ID. This would now all be forced to SSL. And this is the header that you would set. You first?
That way you can also anonymize your header information. If you didn't want to tell the world you were going to Google.com.
Well, you would then always do an DNS request. You would still go to the IP addresses of Google, so I would have a lot of metadata telling me that you went to Google. Yeah.
This trick will only work for subsequent visits. If the man in the middle would catch you in the first visit, he could still man in the middle you.
Yes.
The browser will already have to know that you set an HTTPS.
This is indeed where you can get hacked still. So what you should be able to do is go to that website at least, and the first time should be good. If the first time is bad, then you're down. Yes?
Can this also be server side or only client side?
So what happens is the server pushes this HTTP header to you. Your browser will store it. Firefox and Chrome support this. Internet Explorer 11 supports it as well. Too bad for everybody who's using old stuff. It will store it in memory that for this period of seconds, so this is roughly, what is it, half a year, 3 months, you will always go to that website over HTTPS only and include subdomains. This means that if you have floppyduppy.x.y.z.blah.web.maindomain.com, that for all these subdomains it will also go to HTTPS. Administrative downside is, of course, is that all these subdomains need to be part of or capable of doing HTTPS suddenly. So be careful with installing and using this, because otherwise you need to go to each and every client, ask them to wipe their history, or go to the very horrific HSTS database in Chrome, delete all the entries that the user just passed through manually, and delete it from that database. So there's a good side to this, very good for privacy, very good for security, very bad if you make one mistake. Unknown. I think the latest version from Yosemite actually supports it. I'm not sure about the previous ones. I've never tested it. I know iPhones, iOS do use it and support it. So likely you would think that Safari would as well, but I'm not so sure about that. Okay, so you could make a lot of mistakes, and I'll run through this statement as quickly as possible. The thing is that most, not all the code that you use is, all your clients are browsers. There's a thing called curl, command line tool. Who knows curl? Who doesn't? The rest? Who's silent? Okay. So what happens is that if you have a PHP or .NET website, you would sometimes need to make a connection from your web shop to an intermediate payment provider, like ING or whatever, as banks directly or intermediate payment providers. Or you have a cloud platform control unit, because this is the front page. You click on a button and some action needs to take place in the back end, and sometimes you need to secure this as well. You have machine-to-machine interactions from curl, like my Samsung smart TV, to the whatever Samsung smart TV cloud stuff. That's connectivity done with curl. If you want to really see this, hook up your television on Wireshark and have fun. There's a lot of scary stuff going from my smart TV over to lots of places. And I've all accepted for this because, well, otherwise my TV doesn't work. Anywho, and there are other backend calls based on this stuff. So the paper said curl is totally bad. It sucks. Its tool is broken. So, okay. Yeah. I do a better Gartner than him, but okay. So I figured, I tried to figure out why is this? Why? What the hell? What do you think is bad? Now, what happened is there was a state, so this is fixed many, 2 years ago, so 3 years. There was a verify your certificate chain flag, and there was a verify the combination of this certificate with the host that you were talking to. Was I really connecting to www.kpn.com, or could it be a valid certificate but from another site? That flag didn't have a true false flag, it had a 0, 1 or 2 flag. What the fuck? Off was, should have been, check is off, just take a valid certificate, everything is fine. Could have been stolen from another website, it's all cool. 1 should be the debug, yeah, run through it, just go on, but log what the hell went wrong. 2 is full checks and block when there's a failure. PHP occasionally had code that said SSL_verify host is true. PHP developers here? You had too much. So what do you think would be...
True is 1.
Dun, 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 oops. So your banking notes and your credit card notes and your control of your cloud infrastructure, like just pick one randomly that was in the paper, Amazon, was always running in debug mode. Yes, it completely flagged that this was intercepted, there was a man in the middle attack, I don't care what the hell was wrong. But it was in debugging mode, so it says, yeah, it's really bad. Continue.
They could have fixed it with type checking.
Not everybody was that smart in PHP. True, you could have used type checking. In this case, it was not strongly typed. Therefore, you get all the conversion hubbub, and everybody said blamed curl. While the curl community, hi, part of it, curl community said, you idiots, RTFM. RTFM, read the fucking manual. It's in the manual on how to proceed with this, but they didn't. It should have said a 2. Then again, everybody was saying, yeah, but the other flag was 0 or 1. True, false. And now you have true, false. Yeah. Double true? I don't know. True plus true is? Huh?
These go to 11.
Yeah, this one actually should have gone to 11, but yes. It doesn't, but didn't. So everybody was talking about, okay, but how the hell this went wrong. But this is what's in the paper. In the paper only talked about the OpenSSL SSL TLS implementation. Curl is a very funny beast. Libcurl has a connection to AXTLS, CATLS, GNUTLS for all the Debian lovers. And everybody else, QSO SSL. Anybody want a random stab on what the hell that is? AS400s, yes, so this is mainframe machines from IBM. Totally broken. OpenSSL was the one that's that was discussed and only evaluated by the researchers. And then we have Windows, who uses the Shannon library. Then we have Darwin SSL, which is in iOS and 10 point lots of versions. Polar SSL and NSS. NSS is used by?
NSU.
Netscape.
Yes, the Netscape, not so Netscape, security, secure socket implementation. Mozilla Firefox. So everything which is Firefox or in these days Red Hat Enterprise Server 6 and up uses NSS as their base SSL implementation. Hi. So I had a very interesting Christmas and read all the SSL code for each of the backends, comparing it with all the libcurl code for each of the backends, and then stated and researched, is libcurl plus the SSL code, with both the curl part and whatever you used as APIs on the SSL code, is this RFC 2818 compliant? Yeah. Totally hackable AXTLS, CRSSL, GNU TLS was the only one perfect. QSO SSL so bad that you couldn't even fix it because it didn't have the support on the IBM side to actually do it properly enough. Windows Shannon was good, was a good programmer that actually implemented that. Darwin SSL equally. The OpenSSL, yeah, perfect according to the manual. But the debugging flag, what the hell? NSS was perfect, and Polar SSL also had a bad implementation. Oops. So, yeah. All the SSL backends were fixed in that version of libcurl. Except the QSO SSL, because, yeah, it's closed source, and, yeah, well, I mean, I tried to convince IBM to solve it, but no. Also, the flag now has a no shenanigans solution. It's either zero or anything else, which is basically in full block mode and no more debug mode. So it's easier to program. Just in short, mobile, on why I really laugh at your Androids, and mine as well, though. I mean, I'm also a target to myself. So 802.1x provides authenticity for LAN and wireless, typically used in enterprise networks or anything Eduroam or SpaceNet. Any SpaceNet users? Oh, weinig animo. Okay, so it's a sort of Eduroam, equally set up like Eduroam, but then for hackerspaces over the Netherlands and internationally. Android has an interesting, so it has a layered approach. It has a GUI, it has an API in the OS, and then suddenly it's, for all the Linux users, it becomes pretty easy to understand, because now it's using just WPA supplicant and supplicant.conf file. So if you ever hack your Android or you get root and you walk around the operating system directories, you'll find the supplicant file, which is typically overwritten continuously if you have API calls. Android supports various combinations. Could set a CA certificate to always use for this verification of this link and your credentials, either your personal certificate or username password, which is used here. Username at hva.nl. So this is what it looks like on my end. This wouldn't work, of course, because I have a non-Eduroam compliant anonymous identity. But the problem is there's no subject match or alt name match. So the thing is, any valid certificate would work. If I buy a certificate from StartSSL or StartSSL free certificates for all, I could buy a $5 certificate for my website. I could set up a rogue access point here. I could lure you to my rogue access point, use my hacked free radius installation, and all your Androids wouldn't know the difference because I serve a completely valid and trustworthy certificate and you didn't ever match it to the other matching variables that you could set in Linux. Or my Mac, or Windows, which uses a fingerprint approach than this, but okay, it's a bit different, and Mac also has a slightly different approach to this. So yeah, who the hell am I passing my credentials to? So what you could do at home is install a rogue access point, use free radius WPE, wait for yourself to log on to your own little rogue access point, and yeah, you could play around and see if you can get the MSChop v2 connection, which you should crack then. It takes about roughly 24 hours on a very high intensive cracking surface, but still 24 hours for MSChop v2. Or if you use PAP as an inner connection, then it's basically plain text, easier. And the solution, so these flags will probably be in Google M. And I hope to have my name under that one, just for courtesy. At least that's the only thing I requested. Please put my name on the darn bug fix. Okay, now, just very quickly, Nokia, Asha, and Lumias. You actually already, just if you use the built-in browser, I think they changed browsers now over time, but at that time, 2 years ago, you actually accepted for HTTP connections will be decrypted in a secure manner.
That makes it work.
Well, user incentive, so officially for privacy reasons, you explicitly accepted this statement. Works like this. This is your browser. You have a connection to Finland, to Helsinki somewhere in a data center. This is where they decrypt your SSL proxy. They have some kind of trust model going on, and your SSL connection is then forwarded. So here, everything, so your TAN coders, your ING, logon, all your credentials, whatever, everything is owned by Nokia now. This is because you, here on this side, you have a CA root certificate installed that corresponds with this installation here. And this is a deep-packet inspection solution, which is just used in their normal infrastructure. So you didn't really obliged to use this, but yeah. So I went down hunting. Where the hell is this? So your Express browser, which is called, it moves to ovi.com somewhere, and the proxy agent noted this is Navarro wireless server with a Jetty container, which is old and hackable, by the way. Did it break Nokia? Too bad. So this is the company, Nokia actually owns it, and it's not part of the entire infrastructure. Need to take care of time, I only have 10 minutes. Okay, well, this is the last part. So DigiNotar, I think everybody knows about the DigiNotar stuff, something happened, something, certificates, hacker, blah, blah, Iran. Somewhere in Iran, was this email. Is this a man in the middle? Is this man in the middle attack to Gmail's SSL? I'm sorry for, okay, my Iranian accent is really bad. He tried to log on to Gmail, got a warning by Chrome. This was the error he got in Chrome. So invalid server certificate attempting to reach www.google.com. But the fun part is, if he checked the certificate, it said, "Sir, this certificate is okay." What the fuck? Red screens, bad server, okay. What the fuck? What he didn't know, but later over analysis, he could have seen already that star.google.com was now signed by DigiNotar Public CA 2025, which was signed by the DigiNotar root CA. Google didn't have any business with DigiNotar. They had their own CA already at that time, And the other CA that they were using was DigiCert, if I'm not mistaken. So, yeah, that. Notice the fact that in the beginning of the presentation we had all these purpose-related flags for the certificate. It's similar to TCP's Christmas tree attack. No, I'm glancing, no idea what a Christmas tree attack is. Basically, all the bits were flipped and everything was on. This certificate was golden for everything. So you could be client, you could be do email signing, you could do identities for remote computers, could be your client, it could be, it could also ensure that software came from software publishers, protect the software from alterations, data signatures and signing for time systems, so this is for atomic clocks. Wait a minute, so there's a user, a human, that is working as a server, atomic clock, software security agency and checking a validation service, client server and email. Anything else? So everything was just ticked on, which was interesting. DigiNotar had a lot of CAs. This DigiNotar Cyber CA, extended validation, blah blah blah. But they were also used by TTP info CAs. This is used for backend systems for zakelijk, so businesses to Belastingdienst, tax office. PKI Overheid, so this is DigiD and all the other sites, you name it, gemeentes. Notariële beroepsorganisatie, so you think of even lawyer agencies as well. Including notaries, so that was it was really used everywhere. It was even used in taxi cabs in Amsterdam. In the taxi cab communication systems from the taxi cabs to the main central system. So it was DigiNotar was a CA. They were commercial. They had a private CA. They had all kinds of specific customer CAs, and all kinds of purposes. On August 28th. We just saw the email from the mailing list, 2011. It's already that long ago, jeez. On August 28th, there was a new certificate issued in name of star.google.com, again. And that one got flagged based on the fact that there was a communication and that something funny was going on in the infrastructure of DigiNotar, and then a company called Fox IT performed a forensic research on the infrastructure of DigiNotar on the inside, and not just an audit, which was typically a procedural process-wise. How do you take in the certificate requests? How do you check the owners of the DNS and so on? That was mostly a paper-related audit. But now it seems that all kinds of indicators of compromise were here, stating we've seen this, we've seen this kinds of funny actions. This CA might have gotten hacked. And on the 30th of August, all the browsers, Firefox first, went first and said, okay, we pull the trust of DigiNotar as a root CA. We really want to pull it from our root CA store, because we trust all these hundreds of CAs that we have installed here, and we have to take care of our user community, so we really want to pull it. Discontinue the trust. This was really bad, because this means death to DigiNotar, because if your trust model went out and nobody trusts you anymore, you're out of the trust business. Out of the trust business, you don't have any business anymore. On August the 30th, Firefox got patched, and basically what they said is okay. We have the special DigiNotar blacklist. There's a new function coming in. It takes in the server certificate and the entire certificate chain, checks if runs through the entire list. If there's no issuer name, then okay, continue, blah blah blah. Oh, I see something with the issuer name that has a component called CN is DigiNotar. Yes, we found the DigiNotar thing. Good, good, good. Is it issued by what we at least know, the DigiNotar root CA? Is this one the actual root CA for this? Yes. Okay, well, cutoff period, everything, what is it? Past this date. If it's still valid past this date, it should be stopped with a very hard error. Blah, 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 blah. And return a security error revoked certificate. So anything in the DigiNotar root CA, of all the sub CAs for Staat en Nederlanden, the TTP interfaces, blah blah blah, everything was stopped, halted, and would call for this error. Except the day after that. I had the pleasure of actually talking to the guys that made this call. And I asked if they were slightly insane, or at least understanding the risk they took. Firefox was put under pressure to put in this caveat. As you can see, plus sign, so this is where they added extra code. And what they stated was, if it's a Staat en Nederlander root CA, or Staat en Nederlander CA, because they were running this part of the show, please always say it's okay. The fun part is, on August 30th, this was, I believe, the Wednesday of that week, and the report of Fox IT of the forensics of this entire exercise went out on the Friday. So 2 or 3 days before, they made this call to Firefox to put this piece of code in. This means the entire CA and trust model got hacked. They didn't know how far they got hacked, but they said, okay, but just to let everything run, continue to run and operate with respect to the Staat en Nederlander CAs, the DigiD, the Belastingdienst, everything, please let this stuff continue. If you get hacked and everything can be man in the middle by some hacker, maybe you want to reconsider, but they chose for continuation.
Possible for Mozilla to force push this update without the user accepting the update?
Yes. This went into the nightly on that same day, and the day after it was the update, and I believe they did a forced update. Microsoft has a different power. Microsoft updated the entire world to this to let everybody disable DigiNotar except the Netherlands. So the entire world was patched from this Albanian hacker, but the Netherlands could at least be served their web pages, DigiD, Belastingdienst, everything, and not have this digital havoc.
So how would Firefox check if the incoming update is actually legit from Mozilla itself?
Because they use a different CA, and they, good question, they sign their updates. And the software itself performs a self check if the software is signed with the signature belonging to Mozilla. This is how they do the update checks. And this is what Android and iOS also do with respect to apps and app updates. They need to be signed by the Apple or Android infrastructure, otherwise your phone wouldn't accept it. Or you have to flag for Android accept third-party application installation. So okay, so what about it? The other thing is the sub-CAs didn't enforce a path length constraint. This means that if you have a CA, you could have, they didn't know how far this got hacked, so perhaps it could have hacked the sub-CA, stole it, got back to Iran, and signed all kinds of new certificates out of this. This forensic report wasn't really stated yet. And later, Fox IT couldn't conclude nor deny the opportunity for tampering with this the root CA of the Staat en Nederlander. And because of this, Root's path length constraint wasn't in this certificate, like it should have said zero. No CAs may follow after this in the certificate chain. So this guy, the hacker, could have stolen this root, this private key from the systems and create endless sub CAs and certificates. And because of the automated distribution of sub CAs, your browser wouldn't know the difference that this intermediate CA is between some host certificate and this actual chain that you that you implicitly trust. So this is the downside of this entire thing. Okay, so I'll move up. This is a nice picture. And you see the concentration of the OCSP responder log. So this is to check, is this still valid, yes or no, and where they came from. Here you see a lot of red. It's Iran. Can you guess where all the other red spots over here, here, why you would see those?
Spooks.
Besides the spooks?
Security researchers?
No.
Tor exit nodes. Tor exit nodes. These are all Tor exit nodes. Besides this, this is not the Tor exit node. This is just countrywide at the end border. And this is the SSL termination stuff, which the first guy actually saw. The blue code stuff. Meant to inspect. So this is a feature, right? Inspect your SSL connections. And because he stole the certificates, they could be loaded in this box. And now your browser on the Iran side, Iranian people couldn't, their browsers couldn't see the difference, except for Chrome, who does a fingerprint check. And this is likely what happened. So it's the motivation is to monitor state secrets, but in this case it moved in a lot more, and it's a privacy menace. And the likelihood is that Ixonix, so this guy, actually gave the certificate to the government. So the other thing is, of course, those cages in a bunker, there were multiple cages. And one of the other things that happened, and how he got in and that far, because they shared one, everything was air-gapped except the monitoring network for the one domain controller, seeing if all the CA terminals were connected and still in control. And this was the password that he used to get in. So yeah, everything was in cages, but unfortunately there was still some network wire interconnecting all of these nodes. So yeah, basically all these got hacked, including the rest. And basically everything went out of business. And yeah, well, this Ixonix actually learned a protocol to manipulate the HSM devices from RSA that were used by DigiNotar. Very interesting protocol and programming language. And he had to learn it somewhere, somehow, and he was just devoted, dedicated, had time on his hands and a motivation, which basically brought the house down. So yeah, this was the entire story. Any questions? Last minute. Sorry for stretching time, though.
Okay.
All of this will be in your assignments.
Thank you.